Hello everyone, it's SpawnPoint and it's that time of the year again, it's new TV season. And we're kicking it off with the 77-inch LG G4, which is LG's latest OLED TV. It's brighter, faster, and it has a new 144Hz refresh rate. Now this is the TV that I've been really excited to get unboxed and start using as it only launched this week in the UK. And let me start by saying this thing is ridiculously bright and it looks awesome for both movies and gaming. So today we're going to get this unboxed and set up, and then I'm going to talk you through the specs and how this TV could end up being one of the best TVs in 2024. I'll also compare it to my LG G3 in the coming weeks just to see if it's worth the upgrade. And as always, any questions you've got, just drop those below and I will get back to you. Okay, so here's the box, and it's pretty much exactly the same as the LG G3 box that we saw last year. We've got the LG OLED branding and the new A11 processor, and that comes with the new Brightness Booster Max. Oh, and this thing is huge. I've popped the measurements on screen now in case you planned on picking it up for yourself. Now, although the G4 launched this week in the UK, I actually pre-ordered it from the LG website a couple of weeks ago. So this is a TV that I purchased myself, and at the time of ordering, it also came with a free soundbar called the LG GX. This comes with both the soundbar and a separate sub, which is worth £1,000. I will cover more about this soundbar during my full review, so more on that later. So inside we get the wall bracket, which depending on the size that you go for, you can now get the G4 with a bracket or a tabletop stand. There's also a bag of accessories, which includes the magic remote control, some batteries, the manuals, and an IR blaster. And that's everything that you get inside the box. Okay, so before we put this on the wall, let's take a quick look at the rear. So similar to what we've seen on the previous G series, we've got all of the ports on the right hand side and some trunking to route all of the cables down to the bottom of the TV. Now as this will be flat against your wall, it's great to see that all of the cables will be tucked away. Unfortunately though, the power cable is once again hardwired into the TV, and this is a real pain if you want to feed your power cable through the wall. And it's actually one of the reasons why I had a power socket installed behind the TV last year, as I don't want to have trunking visible where the power cable needs to hang down under the TV. As for the ports, we have a total of 4 HDMI 2.1 ports, all of which offer the full bandwidth and support 4K, 144Hz and VRR. Plus, if you're using a soundbar or an AVR like myself, port 2 can be used for eARC. We then also get various other ports, including 3 USB ports, an Ethernet port, an optical out, and a cable and satellite port. And for those of you that might be using the G3 and are thinking of upgrading to the G4, you'll be pleased to know that the VESA holes and the bracket recess are in exactly the same place, so you can hang it on your wall without needing to move your existing bracket. In fact, the entire back of this TV looks exactly the same as the G3. But here are some measurements in case you need them for your own setup, bearing in mind this is the 77-inch version. Okay, so like with the previous Gallery Edition TVs, the G4 is designed to be wall-mounted, so we do get this bracket inside the box. It's quite a clever design because not only does it come with the instructions to fit it, but it also comes with a paper guide so you can drill and fit it onto your wall. Now this is by far the cleanest wall bracket out there for that ultra-flush look, and it doesn't matter which size you go for, as every G4 is available with this bracket. It also moves out just enough so you can reach behind and swap out any cables when needed. But if you opt for the 55 or the 65-inch version, you also have the choice of a tabletop stand, and this is a first for LG. In the past, you had to buy one of these separately, but you can now choose to buy the 55 and the 65 with this stand. Now, although this does come with a bracket, I'll be using my existing bracket, which I've been using on my 77-inch G3 for about the last year. And the reason I use this generic bracket is because it allows me to swap out TVs for those reviews that I do on the channel. And if you're interested in the one that I'm using, I have linked to this one below. But all you need to do is attach this plate to the back of the G4, and this is using the VESA 300x300 holes. Then it's a case of lifting the TV up and sliding it onto the bracket. Now if I had used the provided bracket, it would have been ultra flush to the wall, which is obviously how it's designed to look. But with the VESA bracket that I'm using, it means it's slightly off the wall by about 2 to 3 cm. It's not ideal, I know, but it means I can refit my Govi lights to the back and get a nice ambient glow against the wall. Right, before I say anything else, let me do the honours. Are you ready? And here it is. This is the 2024 LG G4 OLED. And on first impressions, this looks awesome. I've not even messed with the settings yet, so this is literally straight out of the box with no picture settings changed at all. In fact, I've not even disabled the energy saving mode on it yet. I will do this in a minute, but let's just check out the overall design. Now, looking around, you can see we've got this brushed metal look to the frame, which I think gives it a nice clean style. I mean, maybe it would look better if it was black instead of silver, but then again, it might make the TV look a lot thicker. Either way, whether it's on your wall or on a stand, it is incredibly thin. The bezels are also really thin, as you can see here. It almost looks like it's borderless when you've got a full image up on the screen. There is of course a very slight notch across the bottom, which is where the IR sensor and the power indicator is located, but other than that, it's a really clean design. As for the setup process, not much has changed with the 2024 models. It will talk you through the setup, including choosing your language, reading and confirming the terms, and how you're using the TV. And this is what will be used for the sound setup. You can also test and enable the AI picture and sound options as well. Then once you've done all of that, head over to the settings and check for the latest update, as the chances are there will be something here ready to install. Oh, and I've said this in every single TV video, but if you go to settings, then general, energy saving, and change the energy saving mode from auto to off, you will now immediately see the image brightness pop, and you can manually adjust the brightness yourself. If you've never done this before, you'll wish you had done it sooner. Right, so there's no denying that this TV looks absolutely stunning. I'm hoping you can see just how good this looks here, but the colours, brightness, and clarity are on a whole new level. Now this year we've got another boost in brightness as well, and I honestly cannot get over how bright this screen looks. It's always going to be hard for you to see what I'm seeing through your phone or your screen, but yeah, this looks incredible. So last year we got the MLA tech added to the G3, and this saw a 50% brightness boost over the G2 and even the C3. But this year we're getting another boost with the second gen MLA tech, or the MLA Plus, which is giving us up to a 150% brightness boost mode. 150%. Now I am going to do more testing with the brightness over the coming weeks. I will also compare this to the G3 in my next video, but right now this is blindingly bright. We've also now got our new professional settings under the dynamic tone mapping, and this will allow you to tweak the overall brightness of your HDR content. And this is huge if you want to take full control over how you want your picture to look. As for the colours, well, this is just blowing me away. Before I set this up, I genuinely thought to myself, I'm not going to see much of a difference here as we've still got the filmmaker mode and Dolby Vision and HDR10. But every single piece of content I've watched, I've just gone wow. Skin tones, vibrancy, details, brightness, contrast, just everything. Also, the image and colours look so deep and punchy both during the day and at night. That's obviously not surprising with the pixel dimming OLED tech that we've got and that glossy panel, but this still stands out as being really impressive. Oh, and not only that, but you can now use the filmmaker mode in Dolby Vision as well, so the movies or shows that you're watching will look how the director intended. We then get the same great black levels like any OLED, so throwing up some generic 4K HDR will demonstrate that, and as it supports HDR10 and Dolby Vision, this will be able to support all HDR content that we watch. I mean, just look at those inky blacks. Also, the reflection handling and the glossy finish just look so good, and that's one of the best things about the G4 is how good the reflections are. I can watch this during the day and have no issue seeing what's on the screen. And that's with thanks to both the tinted screen and the brightness levels. Although if you're pointing this TV directly at a window, you will obviously still see it if it's bright enough outside. And then we have gaming, which let's be honest, this TV ticks every single box that we need for it. We know it's got HDMI 2.1, so it can handle 4K, 120Hz, VRR and ALLM, as well as Dolby Vision support. And that makes it perfect for both the PS5 and the Xbox Series S and X. Now, not only does it tick the technical boxes to get the most out of these consoles, it also looks unreal. I can actually dedicate an entire video to just gaming on this TV, but from the gaming that I've done so far over the last few days, it is not disappointed. So here's some gameplay for GT7, as it not only shows off the brightness and the colours, but I'm hoping it will show you just how smooth this looks as well. The motion handling is noticeably a step up from the G3 from my use so far. Not that I had any issues before, but it's definitely smoother with thanks to that A11 processor. And text clarity is another thing. Sure, I could put this under a microscope, but in reality, the text is super sharp for normal TV and gaming. But the big one for this year's model is it now comes with up to 144Hz support for PC gaming. It's not a huge step up from 120Hz, but the fact is, if you're a PC gamer and you fancy using a TV like this, whether it's the 55, 65, 77 or 83, you can squeeze a little more out of it now. It also has Nvidia G-Sync and AMD FreeSync Premium Pro support. But not only that, as every single port on the back is HDMI 2.1, you can have a PC plugged in alongside a PS5 and an Xbox Series X, while also making use of the eARC port for your soundbar or your AVR. And as for the input lag of the G4, well, once you've enabled the boost mode under the prevent input delay on the game optimizer settings, it will bring the input lag down to as fast as a gaming monitor. This means it's literally as fast, if not faster, than most monitors that are out there, so you don't necessarily need a dedicated desk setup when you've got a TV like this. I will of course test the input delay over the coming week just to see how it responds to the different resolutions. Also, the game optimizer mode still has all of the great settings at your fingertips, things like the current frame rate, if HDR is on, and being able to switch between different profiles depending on the game that you're playing. But yeah, on first impressions, this TV is perfect for gaming. Now, a lot of these new changes and improved performance is thanks to the new processor LG have included in the G4. So this year's processor is called the Alpha 11, and this is what's given the TV around a 30% faster processing and improved image. It's also what helps with the new AI processing with things like AI customization, Picture Pro, and Sound Pro. It's able to fine-tune and improve the resolution on the fly as you're watching it. The best way to test this, if you go into the settings, you can actually see the difference between having these modes on and off. Whether you prefer to use them is obviously a personal preference. Okay, let's take a look at the OS, or webOS 24 as LG calls it. It's very similar to what we've seen before with a few slight tweaks. So by pressing the home button on the remote control, it brings up the home screen. From here we have quick access to all of the installed apps, including Netflix, Prime, Apple TV and Disney Plus. We can also see some cards above that, including game and music, where you can access a dedicated area for those. But the big one is you can now create up to 10 profiles. So if each family member want to use a different app layout or even their own picture settings for when they're watching TV, simply by creating a new profile and swapping between the two, it will save their settings. And this is a really good idea if you want to have different picture settings for different family members. There's also something new called the chatbot, where you can search for help and support via the TV. Oh, and we know it supports Apple AirPlay 2 and Google Assistant, but it also now supports Chromecast, so you can cast straight to your TV from any Google devices that you might already have. And one feature that I really wanted to test out was the multi-view mode, as this allows split screen and picture-in-picture modes with up to 4 different views. The great thing is we can now use an HDMI input alongside another app. But unfortunately, it does appear that not all apps are supported. From my testing so far, I can have an HDMI input on one side, like the PlayStation 5, alongside the YouTube app. Now, this is great if you want to do some gaming at the same time as, say, watching a video or maybe even a walkthrough guide. But it would be awesome if we could see some of the streaming apps alongside an HDMI input. Like, can you imagine being able to have the PlayStation 5 on one side and, say, Netflix or Amazon Prime on the other? And then a quick look at the Magic Remote, which looks identical to what we've seen before. It's got the Magic Wand feature, which I still love to use, but the remote control itself still feels pretty cheap. We've then got a scroll wheel in the middle, which is clickable, and those quick access buttons across the bottom, including Prime, Netflix, and Disney+. I was kind of hoping the 2024 G4 might have had a better remote control by now, but there's always next year. So there you have it, that was a quick look at the brand new 77-inch LG G4, and this thing is an absolute beast. I think this could actually end up being one of the best TVs in 2024, but we'll have to wait and see. Now, over the next couple of weeks, I will do a full review where I'll do a deeper dive into things like the audio, text clarity, motion handling, and I'll compare it to the LG G3. This is just to give you an idea of whether it's really worth the upgrade. But I will say, if you've got an LG G3 already and you're thinking of upgrading to the G4, just sit tight and wait for that full review. Now, if you've got any suggestions or questions you want me to cover, please ask those below and I will try to read every single one before the next video. Okay, so if you drop a nice G4 OLED in the comments, I'll give you a thumbs up for staying right till the end. And if you did enjoy today's video, check out my living room tour video next, as that covers everything else I've added to my setup over the last year. Well, thanks for watching. Please like, subscribe, and follow me everywhere. Until next time.